going with additional people as this goes on, but I think we should probably start just to make sure we get through everything in time. We have a lot of, we'll have an intimate conversation today about the 2017 Hollywood Diversity Report. Before we start, we should probably introduce ourselves. These are the co-authors of the report, and if you want to start, Ambria?
Hi, I'm Ambria Sargent, doctoral candidate in the Department of Sociology.
Hi, I'm Vanessa Diaz. I am a visiting researcher here in the Chicano Studies Research Center, and I'm also a postdoctoral fellow housed here at the French Center.
Hi, everyone. I'm Michael Fran. I'm a graduate student researcher for the Ralph J. French Center, and I'm also a fourth-year sociology PhD.
I'm Anna Cristina Ramon, and I'm the assistant director at the French Center for African American Studies.
And I'm Darnell Hunt. I'm director of the Bunch Center and chair and professor of sociology here at UCLA. Okay, so we're going to talk to you about the 2017 Hollywood Diversity Report, setting the record straight, which was released this week, Tuesday, and it went live at 8 a.m. and picked up around the country. And we were particularly interested in the impact the report might have on decision makers in the Hollywood industry, so we spent a lot of time outreaching to industry news outlets like Variety, Hollywood Reporter, LA Times, which is obviously a general interest newspaper, but the industry also reads that paper. So the goal of the report series is to engage with dominant industry discourses about the costs and benefits of diversity. Here's a quote that we like to kind of start these presentations out with that kind of goes to the heart of why all this stuff matters. Okay, so I'll give you a minute or so to read that. So media images, they're important. They shape the way we think about who we are and our place in the world. So, as this diagram tries to illustrate, it's not just entertainment. Media images are entertaining, obviously, but it's not just entertainment. So this is a diagram that refers to what is known in media studies as the circuit of culture. It talks about representation, which is sort of irresistible, common sense, taken for granted, media images or other types of images that stand in for things that we think we know. And the importance of this diagram is it shows the ways in which images wrapped up in representation are related to all these other important things in society, like identity, who we think we are, who we think we aren't, how we kind of compare ourselves to other people and other groups, production, what we produce in society, what we produce in culture, consumption, the things that we think are desirable, that we consume, the way we dress, the music we listen to, all of those things. And last but not least, regulation, the way we sort of identify boundaries around groups, the way we decide who's in, who's out, who's legitimate, who's not. All of these things are wrapped up in representation and the images that circulate. And this is one of the reasons why it's more than just entertainment. Stereotypes, for example, play a role in the way we think about other groups and possibly the way we treat them politically. And right now in the current environment, the current political environment, these issues are probably more important than ever. Okay, so here's a diagram that gives us a sense of what's happening with the US population. The first line here, the blue line, shows us what's happening with the white population over time if we start in 1960 and go to about 2050. And the red line shows us what's happening with the minority population. This is all minority groups combined. And you see the lines cross. They cross in about 2043. From that point forward, America will be majority-minority. As you can see in 2015, minorities constitute about 38% of the population. That's a sizable chunk. Remember that statistic because it will have a bearing on what we talk about later when we talk about representation in Hollywood. So the question we ask in the report is, whose stories are we telling? And I'll give you a hint. For the most part, it's not the line that was kind of going from the bottom up. It's the other line. And the question is, how far off are we from telling those other types of stories? We also ask the question, what is the trend? What are the trends over time? This is the fourth installment in this study series. Our first report came out in 2014, and what we try to do over time is connect the dots from year to year to see if we're actually making progress. Before this report series, most of what we knew about Hollywood diversity was anecdotal. I mean, everyone who works in Hollywood knows it's a tough industry. People of color and women will tell you that it's very tough, but how tough? We didn't really know. I mean, we never had a chance to quantify it before to the degree that we are, and more importantly, to quantify it over time so we can see if we're actually making progress. And that's what this report attempts to do. So let me talk to you about the data we look at. So we look at 168 films released in 2015. Why 168? Every year in the report series, we start with the top 200 films ranked by box office, global box office. And then we subtract out the foreign films because we're focusing primarily on Hollywood. And this year when we do that, we are left with 168 films. We look at 1,206 TV shows from the 2014-15 season. Believe it or not, there are that many titles. Most of them are reality shows. One of the things that you should keep in mind is that we're in something of a golden age of TV. We're producing more TV now than at any other point in history. We have the major broadcast networks. We have more than 60-something cable networks that we look at in the study. And increasingly important are digital platforms like Netflix, Hulu, Amazon, Crackle, etc. Just as a side note, Netflix is making more original programming than even the major networks now. And this is something that's new that wasn't even the case 2 years ago. So TV as we know it is changing, and the TV that we know today won't be here 5 years from now. Lead talent, race, and gender. We're very much interested in who the leads are and what their race is, what their gender is. We'll talk more about that as we get through the study. We look at director race and gender. We look at show creator race and gender in television. We look at writer diversity, who's telling the stories. We look at box office figures and audience demographics. And we look at household, viewer, and social media ratings. Now those last two bits of data are important because one of the things this study does that has really never been done before systematically is connect the dots between diversity in front of and behind the camera and actual bottom line performance. For years, the common sense wisdom in Hollywood was that certain types of things don't do well. Leads of color, for example, don't do well overseas. Well, we can test that now because we have data. We can look at the relationship between people in movies and TV shows and how well those movies and TV shows do in terms of box office and ratings. And that's what we do in the study. So first up, let's look at our findings from film. So this diagram charts film leads over time. And you can see that we go from 2012 to 2015. All right. So we're going to see over the 4 years that we've done this study how this statistic has changed. I should note that we're going to look at white leads, we're going to look at leads of color, which is the minority line, red, and importantly, this yellow line, U.S. population, shows us what happened to the minority share of the U.S. population just over the course of this report series, all right? And more importantly, to the degree that the red line is below the yellow line, minorities are underrepresented in this arena. They're underrepresented among leads, and we talk about the degree to which they're underrepresented. So here are the white shares. So starting in 2012, 84.9% of all film leads from those top films that we talked about were white. And in 2015, we see that 86.4% of them were. So we're actually going backwards in terms of leads across the board in film when we look at minority representation. And here's the corresponding minority line. You see it was 15.1% in 2012, peaked at 16.7% in 2013, but down to 13.6% in 2015. And here's your yellow line. You can see that between 2012 and 2015, the minority share of the population increased from 37% to 38.4%. And I should note that the minority share is increasing by about a half a percent each year, which will get us to that where the lines cross in 2043. So you can see that, you know, minority shares of leads are going backwards while the minority share of the population is going forward. So the gap is actually getting bigger over time, not smaller, all right? Let's look at film leads by gender. We see that in 2012, 69.2% of the leads were male, up to 71% in 2015. So we're going backwards there as well. And here's the figure for women, 30.8% in 2012, down to 29% in 2015. So what about film directors? 89% of the film directors in 2012 were minorities, were white, up to 89.9% in 2015. So again, you know, not a lot of change between the 2 years, but certainly not in the right direction. In fact, as we can see from this slide here, the peak year for minority directors, just like for minority leads, was 2013. And I should note that 2013 was referred to by some in the media as the year of the black film. That was the year the 12 Years a Slave came out, The Butler, and some of these other films. that were critically acclaimed and directed by African-American men and starring African-American leads. And again, if we put the yellow line in, we see that we're well below proportionate representation. In fact, you'd have to triple the number of minority directors in 2015 to reach proportionate representation. What about film directors by gender? 94.2% of the directors were men in 2012. A little bit of improvement, 92.3% in 2015. And the corresponding figure for women, 5.8% in 2012, up to 7.7% in 2015. I should note that women are slightly more than half the population, so if you do the math, you can see that they're underrepresented by a factor of about 12 to 1 among directors. In fact, across our entire study, and this has been consistent over the 4 years, one of the single worst statistics was women and women directors. So, for example, when Ava DuVernay, a few years ago, directed Selma, which got quite a bit of critical acclaim and wasn't even nominated by the Academy, it was doubly egregious because on the one hand, she was a woman and she was a woman of color, which, as you can see from these statistics, is incredibly rare among directors in film. If we look at film writers by race, we see that 92.2% of the writers in 2012 were people of color, were white, up to 94.7% in 2015. So again, we're going backwards among writers in film as well. Here's the minority line, 7.8% in 2012, down to 5.3% in 2015. If we look at the yellow line, we see that you'd have to multiply by 5 the number of minority writers in 2015 for the group to reach proportionate representation. If we look at gender, 87% of the writers in 2012 were men, 87%, the exact same number in 2015, so treading water here. And you can see the line for women, 13%. You'd have to multiply the number by 5 before women would reach proportionate representation among writers in film. So the picture, as you can see, isn't all that great in film, which, of course, is consistent with what we've seen the last few years with Oscars So White. You know, I mean, it's hard to be nominated and win awards at the Oscars if they're not making films, or films aren't sort of directed by and starring people of color. The roles just aren't there in the same way. So let's look at TV and see how TV compares to film. So here we have a similar table or chart to the one we saw for film leads, but here for broadcast. And we're separating broadcast from cable so we can look at some of the differences, because there are some differences between broadcast and cable. Again, we have the blue line for white leads, the red line for minority leads, and the yellow line telling us what's happening with the US population. So you can see here that there's actually a downward trend for white leads in broadcast. 94.9%, incredibly high number, in 2011-12 were white, down to 88.6% in 2014-15. The corresponding line for minority leads then is an upward trend, 5.1% in 2011-12, up to 11.4% in 2014-15. So we actually see some signs of progress here. The minority share of leads is actually more than double over the course of our study. So we're seeing some progress there. And just think about, if you watch television, some of the shows that are on now on many of the broadcast networks, on ABC in particular, where pretty much you're hard-pressed to find a show on ABC that's not very diverse. So there is some movement in broadcast TV on this front that we haven't seen thus far in film. That said, we still have a long way to go. You have to multiply by 5, by 3 or 4, the number of minority leads in broadcast to reach anything approaching proportionate representation. Let's look at broadcast leads by gender. So what's interesting here is that in the first 2 years of our study, women were close to proportionate representation. They were roughly or approaching half of the leads. But then by 2013-14, there was a drop-off down to 35.8% of the leads, and a slight increase this last year up to 38.2% of the leads. All right, so women aren't quite there. They'd have to kind of increase their share considerably to get back up to anything approaching proportional representation like they did in the first 2 years. Let's look at cable leads by race. So So here we see in 2011-12, 85.3% of the leads were white, down slightly to 84.2% in 2014-15. The corresponding line for minorities, 14.7% in 2011-12, up to 15.8% in 2014-15. Now, one of the things you'll notice is that the minority shares are a little bit higher in cable than they were in broadcast. Well, why is that? Because cable is a little different than broadcast in the sense that the networks tend to be more niche marketed or targeted toward particular market segments. So you have the BETs, for example, or the Oprah Winfrey networks, or the TV1s targeting African American audiences. You have El Rey Network, which is targeted more toward Latino audiences. And so for those reasons, you know, on those networks, all of the shows pretty much have leads of color. So the mix overall is a little bit better than what you see in broadcast. But when you look at the yellow line, again, you still have a ways to go. You have to multiply the number of minority leads in cable by more than two to reach proportionate representation, even in cable. If we look at cable leads by gender, we see that 62.8% of the leads in 2011-12 were men, up to 64.4% in 2014-15. So again, going backwards in terms of gender in cable. The corresponding line for women, 37.1% in 2011-12, 35.6% in 2014-15. If we look at show creators, and this is important, show creators are the people who pitched the idea originally for a show, either to the talent agency, the network, or whomever is buying. And this is important because it sets in motion a whole chain of other events. Obviously, if you pitch a show about a black family, well, it's probably going to have a black lead, right? It's probably going to have other black characters. If it's a show about a white family, it's probably not going to have that. So the basic idea, you know, kind of sets the constraints for the other types of diversity that are likely to happen. It also tends to influence who's going to be in the writer's room, the types of stories you're going to tell, and what that writer's room is going to look like. Well, what we see here is that in 2011-12, 95.8% of the show creators were white. It doesn't leave a lot for people of color. By 2014-15, it improved a little bit, 92% were white. The corresponding line for people of color, only 4.2% of the show creators in 2011-12, up to 8% in 2014-15, so not quite double. So kind of similar to the trend we saw with leads, right? Well, one of the things that we tend to see is that if you have show creators of color, you tend to have leads of color. So those things kind of go hand in hand. We're going to see a similar pattern with writers. But if you put the yellow line in again, we see that we are still woefully underrepresented. You'd have to multiply the minority share by about five to get the proportionate representation. If we look at broadcast show creators by gender, we see that 73.5% of the show creators were men in 2011-12, up to 77.6% 2014-15, again going backwards in terms of gender. And here's the corresponding line for women, 26.5% in 2011-12, down to 22.4% in 2014-15. Again, women are slightly more than half the population, so you have to double that number, more than double it, for them to reach proportionate representation. If we look at cable show creators, again, think back to what we said earlier about the way cable is slightly different than broadcast. In 2011-12, 92.6% of the show creators were white, 92.5, almost the exact same number in 2014-15. So we basically treaded water over the last 4 years, not a lot of progress at all. The corresponding numbers for minorities, 7.4% in 2011-12, 7.5% in 2014-15. Here's the yellow line. You have to multiply that by about five times or so to reach proportionate representation. Cable show creators by gender, 78.5% were men in 2011-12, 79.1% in 2014-15. And here are the numbers for women. Again, very similar to what we saw before, you'd have to more than double the woman's share to kind of get to proportionate representation, which was, you know, 20.9% in 2014-15. So here we're going to look at writers, and the way we look at writers is we look at all the episodes that were made for a show in a given season, and who got writing credit for that particular episode, all right? And we count that up, and we look at the share of those credits that went to minorities. All right. So what did we find? In 2012-13, 92.3% of the credits went to white writers. By 2014-15, that share had decreased to 86.6%. And the corresponding increase you saw for people of color from 9.7% in 2012-13 up to 13.4% in 2014-15. So again, the shape of this line is very similar to the one we saw for minority leads in broadcast and minority show creators in broadcast. An upward trend. So we're actually seeing progress in broadcast. I mean, the theme so far is pretty much abysmal everywhere else, but we're seeing some progress in broadcast. And there's the yellow line, so you have to basically triple the minority share to reach proportionate representation. If we look at the same analysis for gender, we see that 68% of the credited writers were women in 2012-13, down to 64.1% in 2014-15. Again, this is in broadcast, you're seeing a little bit of progress for women here. The line is going up. Still, it's below proportionate representation, but it's going in the right direction. If we look at credited writers in cable, we see kind of the reverse. Things aren't looking so good. They're not going in the right direction. 82.8% were white in 2012-13. 89.4% of the credited writers were white in 2014-15. So the minority share actually goes down from 11.8% in 2012-13 to 10.6% in 2014-15. If you look at the yellow line, you see that you have to multiply that nearly by 4 to reach proportionate representation. If we look at credited cable writers by gender, 70.5% in 2012-13, 69.4% in 2014-15, not a lot of change for men. And again, the corresponding women's share, 29.5% in 2012-13, 30.6% in 2014-15, again, below proportionate representation. So we also looked at episodes, directed broadcast episodes, and again, what share of those episodes were directed by people of color. And what we found in broadcast was that the white share steadily declined from 92.5% in 2012-13 down to 86.1% in 2014-15, and of course, a corresponding increase for the minority share from 7.5% in 2012-13 to 13.9% in 2014-15, again, following the same pattern that we saw for broadcast leads of color, broadcast show creators of color, and broadcast writers of color. So again, lots happening in broadcast. It's actually a good story, you know, one of the few good stories we can tell about the industry so far. But given that, you know, minorities are still underrepresented by a factor of, you know, less than 3-to-1 among directors of episodes. Looking at gender, again, we see things moving in the right direction in broadcast. 88.7% of the episodes were directed by men in 2012-13, down to 82.9% in 2014-15, and the corresponding increase for women from 11.3% of the episodes to 17.1% of the episodes. And again, it's still underrepresentation by a factor of about 3-to-1. Directing has been particularly difficult for women, both in film and television. A little bit better in television, but horrendous in film, as we saw. So if you move on to cable and look at directed episodes, we see that in 2012-13, 87.3% of the episodes were directed by people by white directors, 86.6% in 2014-15. Yeah, a slight increase, but not all that much to speak about. And the corresponding figures for directors of color, 12.7% of the episodes in 2012-13 and 13.4% in 2014-15. And when you put in the yellow line, you see that that's still underrepresentation by a factor of a little bit less than 3-to-1. Looking at the same thing by gender, we see that in 2012-13, 88.8% of the episodes were directed by men, 87.6% in 2014-15. Again, not a lot of progress. And you can see the line for women is pretty stable, 11.2% in 2012-13. Up slightly to 12.4% in 2014-15. And now we move to the punchline, the bottom line. Okay, so remember earlier in the presentation I said that one of the things that's unique about our study is that we look at all of these statistics that we've been presenting about diversity in front of and behind the camera, and we try to look at how diversity, particularly in terms of cast, overall cast diversity, relates to how profitable a TV show or a movie is. so that we can address some of the myths and some of the conventional wisdoms that have sort of directed decision-making in the industry over the years. So this first table looks at box office for theatrical film releases by minority cast share. And the question we ask ourselves is, if you take all of those 168 movies for 2015 and you put them into different categories based on what their cast looks like, that is to say, movies that have cast that are less than 11% minority, movies that have cast that are from 11 to 20% minority, from 21 to 30% minority, from 31 to 40% minority, 41 to 50% minority, and 51% and over, in other words, majority-minority cast, how do they do relative to each other in terms of box office? In other words, you know, is there a relationship between diversity and how profitable a film is overall? And so what we're looking for is, if we chart this over this series here, you know, where does the line peak? You know, where is it the highest? Well, what we found in 2015 was that for films that were from 21 to 30% minority, that's where box office peaks. The films that fell into that category, on average, well, the median actually, was $105 million, all right? It's worth noting that on the other end of the distribution, films that were less than 11% minority, on average only earned about $41.9 million. And the largest number of films actually fell into that category. In other words, about 38% of the films made in 2015 had cast that were 11% minority or less. And another 23% of the films had cast that were only from 11 to 20% minority. In other words, over 60% of all films made in Hollywood that year had cast that were less than 20% minority. And films on that end of the spectrum didn't do all that well in terms of profitability. And so you have to ask yourself, why is the industry making a whole bunch of films that aren't very diverse that are performing poorly? When, meanwhile, films that are from 21 to 30% minority actually had the highest median box office. So that's a question that we'll return to at some point. But just to kind of give you a sense of what films fell into that 21 to 30% category in 2015, films like Spectre, Ant-Man, San Andreas, and Fantastic Four, all right? So here we do the same thing for broadcast scripted TV shows. Remember in broadcast we saw that we've actually seen some improvements in terms of diversity in front of behind the camera. So where do ratings peak in broadcast if we do the same type of analysis in terms of the cast of the TV shows? Well, lo and behold, ratings peak for shows that are from 41 to 50% minority. Quite diverse. Those shows, on average, get the highest ratings of any shows on TV. And so just to kind of give you an example of shows that fell into that category in 2014-15, there were shows like Brooklyn Nine-Nine on Fox, Elementary on CBS, New Girl on Fox, and Sleepy Hollow on Fox. It's also worth noting that 21% of broadcast scripted shows for 2014-15 had cast that were less than 11% minority. In other words, the far end here, which is actually not that bad in terms of ratings, but it's not as doesn't do as well as shows that were more diverse. And another 27% had cast that were only between 11 and 20% minority. And again, the ratings there were quite lower than the ratings you see on shows that are more diverse. So again, you're asking yourself, why are so many shows being made that aren't very diverse, that don't do as well as shows that are more diverse? One of the advantages we have in television is that Nielsen, the company that we get our data from to look at how well shows do, also have new measures for social media engagement for shows. So they look at how many times particular shows are tweeted about, right? And that's considered to be a measure of how engaged the audience is with the show. The more tweets, the better, obviously. So we do the same type of analysis here where we replace the conventional rating with the Twitter rating to see where tweets peak for shows with different types of cast diversity. And what we find in broadcast is that tweets peak for shows that are from 31 to 40% minority. And that interval is notable. Why? Because the minority share of the population falls within that interval, 38.4% in 2015. So, in other words, the picture we're getting from broadcast is TV shows that look like more like America are the shows that are getting the highest ratings. when in fact the industry is making a lot of shows that don't look like America and they're not doing as well. If we look at ratings for cable, the story is a little bit different because cable is a little bit more complicated for the reasons I mentioned earlier. We actually see that ratings peak at a lower level of diversity, 11 to 20% minority. And this is 18 to 49 viewer ratings. Now, I don't show you this, but if I could, you know, kind of superimpose on this chart household ratings for black households, white households, Latino households, Asian American households, which we have, the patterns there are a little bit different. For black households, it's off the chart for majority-minority shows, as you might imagine. So they're watching the Oprah Winfrey Network shows, the BET shows, the TV One shows, all on cable that you don't have in broadcast, so that's why the shape of the chart's a little different. For Latino and Asian American households, it's for shows that are from 31 to 40% minority. So in other words, they're watching different shows as well. And then for white households in 18 to 49, which you see here, it's for shows that are from 11 to 20% minority. But the thing to keep in mind is that minorities already make up 38.4% of the population, plus they over-index in terms of watching television. They watch more TV per capita than whites. So one of the arguments we're making in the report is that we're getting to the point now where minorities are actually driving ratings in TV and driving box office, which we'll talk about a little bit more as well. And they're actually having an influence that exceeds their share of the population. And this is only going to become more true with each passing year as their share increases by about 100%. If we look at tweets in cable, we see that tweets peak for shows that are from 21 to 30% diverse in cable. So I've gone on for a long time, so let me just wrap up really quickly. So we kind of conclude the report by talking about what all this means. On the one hand, you know, we're kind of struggling with diversity in the industry in front of, behind the camera. The only real bright story is what's happening in broadcast. And on the other hand, consistently over 4 years, and we found this year in, year out, diversity sells. You know, diverse audiences want diverse content, and it shows in terms of where ratings peak in TV and where box office peaks in film. So we kind of conclude the report by saying that, you know, obviously diversity is not everything. If you have a horrible story and a horrible cast, it can be very diverse and no one will probably watch it. On the other hand, diversity is a plus factor. If you have a great story, if you have good performances, and if you add diversity to the mix, you're gonna reap the benefit. And that's the message to the industry. So we will stop there. Here is the report. It's available now for download. You can go to our website. It's the first thing that pops up and you can download the entire 86-page report, which is very detailed with about 100 charts, a lot more detail than I talked about today, but you can get the gist. So at this point, I'm gonna shut up. I'm gonna turn it over to my co-authors to kind of talk about, you know, how they came to this project and how it relates to the work they do.
Thank you. So I hope that you all can stay because we have a lot of great projects here that the other co-authors would like to discuss. And one thing to really note too in terms of what the research that we did and then what Dr. Hunt was talking about right now is that people of color, their buying power in 2015 was $3.5 trillion. So trillion with a T, right? And you know, for Asian Americans and Latinos, they have the fastest growing buying power of any of the other groups. So you can just imagine in terms of, you know, what the market looks like and what it will be very soon. And you know, the studios and the networks, they need to pay attention to that. And I think that slowly they are with the research that, you know, that we're doing, and obviously with just their own analysis of the market. But that's just definitely something to remember that, you know, if you have a conversation with anybody and they say like, well, why diversity? Like, what's the big deal? Why is this important? You know, you can just talk about the buying power. And if they're interested in money and not about social justice, then you know that has to be a big selling point in terms of just the buying power of people of color and what they, you know, they're willing to do to see themselves reflected on screen and what TV shows they will watch and you know what movie tickets they will buy. So So then that's just, you know, I just wanted to convey that. But I also quickly just wanted to share that, you know, the research that we do for this report, you know, comes out every February, but it's a year-long process and it requires a lot of labor-intensive hours. And, you know, we have a team, besides the co-authors, we have a team of six graduate student researchers that are working mainly year-round on the data collection. And here, Michael Tran, he's our lead graduate student researcher on the project in terms of, he helps with all aspects of it. So that's definitely something that, you know, requires lots of hours. The data, that the way that we collect it is independent of the studios and at work, so we use our own sources that the industry also uses, so we're not dependent on the studios for the data that we collect. And in addition, though, we do go out to the studios and networks because we want to have them use our research and to influence, have our research influence their decisions that they're making. And so we ask them to sponsor our research, but at, you know, nominal levels, and that way they have some form of investment, so that when we come out with our report, that we can, you know, go back to them, and then we can discuss our findings, and they have some kind of need to get, you know, back to us and to listen to us because they gave us some money to support it. So we definitely, you know, want to make sure that we're influencing the decisions and showing that you know, these are the numbers and that they need to listen to them. That's also just, you know, something that's in the beginning of the report. You can see that we have this past year we had 10 networks and studios that sponsored us. But I'll just then. We'll go on to introduce Michael Tran, and he'll talk about his research and how it relates to our project.
Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for coming. And I just wanted to speak briefly about one small area of overlap between my own research and the research that we're doing here at the Bunch Center. So one of the real strengths of this report is emphasizing the importance of diversity both in front of and behind the camera. And that space behind the camera is extremely important, because not only are the faces of people of color being represented on the screen, but also when you have storytellers behind the camera, it also means that the stories and experiences of people of color are also going to be communicated in the mass media. So in my own research, I studied the experiences of independent filmmakers of color, and I hope that some of the way they see their work and how they approach it will be useful for seeing why this, you know, having people of color behind the camera is so important. And just a hint of where the conclusion is going to go, I hope that Hollywood's going to recognize that there's a huge untapped wellspring of original, creative, and compelling content that's not being communicated when we have, you know, show creators, writers, and directors being so severely underrepresented. So often what I hear from independent filmmakers of color when they talk about their craft is that they're primarily concerned with sharing and communicating the experiences of the people that they know, that they're intimately familiar with in their communities, that aren't being represented in our media today. So, you know, there's a sort of myth of the auteur in Hollywood, but something that you can find with a lot of independent filmmakers of color is that there's a more collective and social responsibility towards what they do. In keeping with that, I also hear a lot of filmmakers talking about trying to move the society along with their craft. One example of that could be combating stereotypes. It's been a knotty issue for decades and decades in Hollywood, but just the mere inclusion of people of color from underrepresented communities helps to allay that, because it's much easier to combat stereotypes, to add variation to a lot of these cliches, if you're just representing the people around you that you know and you love, your family, your community members, your neighbors, etc. And thirdly, a kind of overarching project that I see with independent filmmakers of color is to make sure that our visual culture, our mass media that we're all partaking in, is a kind of culture that all of us can feel that our stories are reflected in and that we're all participating in. So it's kind of more democratic. underlying issue. So you can easily imagine how minority audiences would be attracted by this, why they find it empowering and validating. But just a little plug to the industry decision makers, this is also a great source for original content. What we've seen in the last few years is that studios and networks are hungry for projects that will capture the public's imagination. So you can see shows like Transparent or shows like Orange is the New Black really put digital platforms on the map. You know, Amazon Studios and Netflix are on everybody's mind because of these shows that have captured the public's imagination. What we've seen in just the last year is that very specific stories about minority experiences can do the same thing with movies like Moonlight and shows like Atlanta. So I hope, I don't know if anybody in the press can communicate this, I hope that the Academy this weekend and Hollywood decision makers for years to come recognize that not only is diversity the right thing to do, as is clear from face value, or you know, perfectly good business sense, as we prove in our report, but it can also be a source of this, a great source for untapped, you know, creative, compelling, and good art. Thank you.
I'm going to look to my notes a little bit. So my research looks at another area of the entertainment industry, but I'm going to connect it back to the project as well. So I look at racial politics and the division of labor in the production of celebrity weekly magazines, like People and Us Weekly, and specifically I look at work on the red carpet and paparazzi. So the paparazzi are actually predominantly Latino, and the red carpet reporters are primarily white women, so I look at those racial dynamics. And the number of paparazzi in LA drastically increased from 2002 to 2008 due to an explosion in the number of celebrity weekly magazines in that time. And so Latinos made up the majority of these new paparazzi in such large numbers that by 2008, that was regularly discussed that the industry went from being all white guys to mostly Latino men. And news media wrote about this, and it was kind of a conversation that was initially acknowledged but never really critically analyzed beyond that. And so a number of factors contributed to that demographic shift, and I don't have time to really address that today, but I can say that after an initial bout of articles sort of addressed this, it became largely ignored by the industry and has allowed for really intensely racialized moments to arise between media, celebrities, and paparazzi without any formal acknowledgement of what it means to have these men of color producing celebrity culture. So 2 years ago, Chris Rock in the essay he wrote for The Hollywood Reporter talked about the lack of Latinos in Hollywood. And the thing is that there are Latinos doing work in Hollywood, it's just a disenfranchised kind of labor. It's freelance labor, it's contingent labor, it's stigmatized labor, it's ridiculed labor. And so this is kind of the intervention of my work, is to look more closely at the racial politics in this work and see where people of color are actually overrepresented in Hollywood and what kind of labor that is. And how that labor is treated. So paparazzi have always been hated. And so what I'm looking at is what happens when a group of already hated laborers becomes racialized. And so the unique positions that paparazzi occupy demographically, professionally, within the labor chain of celebrity media production have made them really convenient but very problematic scapegoats for the current climate of celebrity obsession in the US. And this scapegoating has actually led to paparazzi facing violence and even death on the job. So it allows for overt racism that occurs under the guise of them just sort of being bad people because they're paparazzi and paparazzi are looked at like discussed by the industry, instead of looking at the fact that they are fulfilling labor that's demanded by corporate media, while paparazzi remain the sort of targets of the disgust within the celebrity industrial complex. Anti-paparazzi laws actually target paparazzi specifically. They're the ones liable for any breaking of the laws for taking the photos, but corporate media are completely relinquished from any responsibility in terms of publishing claims. They can't be sued for publishing photos that were taken in violation of anti-paparazzi laws. Only the paparazzi can be sued. And a lot of the anti-paparazzi legislation actually mimics, not surprisingly, anti-immigrant kind of sentiment. So particularly after the Oscars to White movement over the last few years, we continue to be in this moment of really publicly
and critically dissecting the entertainment industry and understanding that the problems are not just about one institution within the industry, right? It's not just the Academy, it's not just broadcast and cable. It's all of the institutions within the industry across the board. So the division of labor by racial lines in the celebrity magazines is just one part of the same problem we're looking at in the study. So in that essay by Chris Rock that I mentioned, he also talks about Hollywood and the entertainment industry as being very liberal. So I just want to really quickly connect this to the election and the study. There have been a lot of conversations about surprise and sort of disgust among white liberals in response to the election. And I think that much of the reaction from like Hollywood sort of reflects this tendency. A lot of Hollywood figures were up in arms over the election because they didn't want the person they viewed as, you know, the conservative or a white supremacist candidate to win. And at the same time, these Hollywood figures are often among those who ignore the very exclusionary racial politics that exists within the entertainment industry. So in many ways, Hollywood is a perfect example of white liberal America. With the exception of people like Clint Eastwood, it's extremely democratic. Hollywood actors and producers are consistently among the largest donors to the Democratic Party. Just in this last year, Steven Spielberg donated over $1 million to Hillary Clinton's campaign. And a lot of them certainly fancy themselves, at least, liberals and non-racist. So like Judd Apatow, for example, was one of the most outraged, you know, he's a famous director, outraged over the election, but how many people of color does he put in his films, right? Madonna was really speaking out against the elections, but she made the decision to play one of the most famous Latin American women in history when only 3 Latinas have ever been nominated for an Oscar for Best Actress, and none have ever won. So these are things that happen in Hollywood every day. It's part of the sort of larger texture. And just to point out that many white celebrities, especially white women, were offended by the hashtag #OscarsSoWhite and spoke out against it. And there were op-eds, tweets, and a lot of other kinds of communication from white Hollywood, especially white women, pointing out what I refer to as the Hollywood version of All Lives Matter, right? So Helen Mirren, you know, Oscar-nominated actress, said it was unfair for people to blame the Academy for problems of diversity. Actress Charlotte Rampling said #OscarsSoWhite was racist to whites. Actress, director, and screenwriter Judy Delby complained that her concerns over lack of women in the Academy were ignored and said, quote, "I sometimes wish I were African-American because people don't bash you afterward." So this isn't divorced from the Trump election or this larger context about problems of diversity across the industry. We all know about possessive investment and whiteness, which is a term by George Lipschitz, and Hollywood as an industry has this possessive investment in whiteness. And so my hope is that all of these good liberal folks within the industry who are speaking out against Trump and, you know, the various problems he's causing in minority communities especially, is going to start to do the hard work that everyone needs them to do around issues of diversity and entertainment and address these very real and very disgraceful numbers that the Hollywood Diversity Report has once again revealed.
Hi, I'm Amber Sargent again. I will be brief to allow some time for some questions before we wrap up. The one significant area of overlap between the findings of the report and my own independent research speaks to this underrepresentation of women in film, but I focus on television. So I have done a participant observation of 3 areas of the comedy industry. And by participant observation, I mean that I have worked as a stand-up comedian and a television writer, and have done some on-camera work for the past 3 years looking at these three different aspects. So I examine women's experiences in stand-up, in the writer's room, and also in a couple of comedic television productions. So what the report kind of indexes are these tangible, systemic ways in which women are barred from TV and film. So lack of management or agency representation, certain financial obstacles that make it difficult for them to have internships or finish films. But what I do is kind of look at the qualitative aspects, right? What is the context in which women are entering the industry that makes it hostile to them? And what I find is that women's experiences, these interactions that they have in these various aspects of the industry, are shaped by their intersectional identities, right? So race, by sexuality, by their physical attractiveness, by body size, by age, and also their experience. So when we talk about the scarcity of women, we can't make women this monolithic group, right? That women have these varying experiences based on these different categories that privileges certain women and also disadvantages other women. So I'll be happy to answer more questions about that if you have them, but that is the focus of my own work.
So I guess we'll take the time we have left to answer any questions you guys may have. Let's start right here.
First of all, thank you for the panel and for having this release event. I'm really enthused to be here. My name is Dr. Anita Kwan Johnson. I'm the chair of diversity at the New York Film Academy. And my sister, Monica Maser, is the showrunner for Queen Sugar.
Oh, okay.
So,
great.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
She also, at one point, used to work on Lost. And because mm-hmm. we're half African American and half Korean, it was the first opportunity in the writer's room that she wrote for the African American and the Korean characters. So my question, sort of given New York Film Academy and sort of my personal sort of mixed racial background, mm-hmm. I was wondering which networks or studios you found more or less sort of diversity friendly? And then I guess, you know, as a mentor for students that are about to enter, students of color that are about to enter the industry, if you found, as far as spikes and declines in the research for the various charts, if you would attribute that to more or less successful mentorship programs, whether they were internship programs or writing fellowship programs.
Right.
So I was just wondering, so, maybe the general question, you know, which networks slash studios were more or less diversity friendly, and maybe to piggyback on that, you know, if it was due to a sort of an internship or a writing fellowship program that might have been aligned with that network or studio.
Yeah, let me take a crack at that, and then I'm curious to see what other people have
okay.
to say. But so one of the things we look at in this year's report is diversity initiatives.
Okay.
And so we did a survey of kind of like the different types of initiatives that are out there. But I think the conclusion we reach is that they're definitely needed because things would probably be a lot worse without diversity initiatives, but they're not the answer. You
okay.
know? There are structural problems with the industry in terms of who's at the very top in the executive suites, who's making green lighting decisions about what gets made, what type of budget, et cetera, that really shapes the opportunity structure for everybody else.
Okay.
And right now, it's mostly white men in those positions who have a particular type of experience, a particular set of tastes, and what they think is good, what they think is viable, which often precludes women and people of color from really getting a shot at the sort of, you know, prestige projects, the major movies, the big budget type things. And that kind of, despite all of the diversity initiatives, sort of reproduces the same type of production that we see year in, year out. So we see some, you know, signs of progress in broadcast, which I'll get to in a second, the question about which networks or whatever. But for the most part, we saw a lot of treading of water. We don't see a lot of like wholesale change. I mean, all this talk about diversity for the last few years, I mean, things haven't gotten worse markedly. They've gotten a little better in some places, but it hasn't been the sea change that one might otherwise think. And that's why you have to do a study like this, so you can actually look at the bird's eye view. With that said, we do look at the bird's eye view, and we do not do a network by network breakout or a studio by studio breakout. But I can tell you anecdotally, and well, actually, it is rooted in data too. The ABC, I mean, you know, I think I referenced that earlier in my remarks. I mean, it's not accidental they have an African American woman who's the head of the network, the first African American, first woman to head a major network. And, you know, she was responsible when she was head of drama development for a lot of the projects that Shonda Rhimes brought to light, who is arguably the most powerful woman in television right now, and certainly an African-American woman who is probably ABC's biggest asset. So the woman that brought Shonda Rhimes up became the head of the network, another African-American woman. Makes sense, right?
Right.
And ABC is doing really, really well in that respect. It's hard to find a show in the network that's not very diverse. And they have shows probably for like the second or third Asian-American cast show in history, you know, Fresh Off the Boat, whatever you may think of the show,
right.
It's on ABC.
And
there are other Latino themed shows as well.
And Margaret Cho,
yeah.
Scene Network, Margaret Cho was a predecessor.
Right, All American Girl, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So ABC clearly is diversity friendly. In fact, that is their marketing niche right now. That's the way they see themselves. Now, you know, it remains to be seen how that will play out in terms of the perceived quality you may think of some of the shows or whatever, but certainly that is where they've kind of pitched their tent right now. And that's not as true at other networks. I think all of the networks are getting a little better, hence the increases we're seeing in broadcasts, but some more than others.
Maybe talk about the diversity initiatives, because Ambria was in charge of that.
Sure, and I think Darnell's statement pretty much sums up their effectiveness. Again, diversity initiatives don't necessarily mean inclusion, right? So again, what are the conditions in those writers' rooms, in those spaces, those internships for participants of color? Are they being included? Are they being tokenized? How do we not only just use diversity as a buzzword, but create a context under which talent feels comfortable in those spaces? So again, diversity initiatives are important, but how do we create a sustainable pipeline of talent that over time will produce diversity, not just kind of like in a one-by-one kind of way?
Diversity is a two-way street. I mean, there's the pipeline issue, but there's also the opportunity issue. I mean, are they going to actually create spaces for those people at the very, very top?
Sure. Okay.
And that hasn't happened at all. There's been no progress there at all, with the exception of like a Channing Dungey, you know, the ABC.
And often they don't result in any kind of staffing position.
Right.
That they are termed, and it doesn't guarantee employment post the tenure of that particular initiative or program.
Yeah.
Good question.
So first, Professor Hunt, thank you for the work that you and your team do every year to provide this data, which is very, very helpful for those of us who do advocacy work for diversity and inclusion in Hollywood. I'm the chair of the Asian Pacific American Media Coalition, which has worked in a coalition with NAACP, Filipinos, and Americans since the year 2000 to create the diversity initiatives that have been members of all. And we've always been pitching the idea that you should do diversity not just because it's the right thing to do, which it is, but because you can make more money doing it.
Right.
And have this kind of data is important for that purpose. Secondly, just very quickly, I know that you do get some funding from the studios and networks and all that. And I want to commend you that you don't pull any punches when you do that. That's great.
You totally
but you've been doing this for a while. And showing that it sells, when you go to them, do they say, what do they say? I mean, are they in fact saying, whoa, I should change my whatever I'm doing?
Yeah, you know, I think it's fair to say, I think I'm curious to see, I mean, you can chime in because I think, you know, Dr. Ramon and I have, you know, met with a lot of these companies. We meet with them year in, year out. And they'll say, you know, when we meet with them, you know, our report intentionally gives you the bird eye view. We don't do the breakdowns. We don't give report cards for different network studios, that type of thing. That's what the advocacy groups do. And we, you know, work closely with the advocacy groups. We share data with them. But that's not the position that we put ourselves in. So when we meet with the companies, though, they will often ask us, well, can you put our numbers? You know, here are the list of shows we want to look at. Here are competitor shows. And we want to see how we stack up in terms of diversity. And we've done that for a number of our sponsors. And they're very receptive to that. And the question is how far up the chain the information goes. Because we typically meet with vice presidents who are responsible for diversity, in some cases in production and not just personnel. But they're not the final decision maker at the end of the day in terms of what the network programs. So, you know, my sense is that at a company like ABC Disney that is very engaged with what we do, and in fact, they've already been reaching out to us for our annual meeting to kind of go over the finding. They really do talk about this seriously internally. And I think it shows in terms of what the network has been doing. ABC is our most consistent network supporter. We've not had much interaction with Fox or with NBC. CBS has supported us a few times. But again, the interaction hasn't been at the level that it's been with ABC Disney. And then we have a number of studios like Lionsgate and other networks and cable, like HBO or major companies like Time Warner, who are also very interested in what we're doing and will ask us to run their numbers and, you know, by division and see how they stack up. So the conversations are happening, and we think that's an important first step. And more importantly, I think the conversations are happening in the context of profitability, like, you know, how this stuff plays out, which I think at the end of the day is what's going to make the difference.
Thank you.
it's really like we get in touch with, like what Dr. Hearn was saying in terms of the diversity officers or executives, and then they also have corporate and social responsibility you know, officers as well. And so then we work with them to be like the advocates, like for the data, so that they can push, you know, the data up, you know, to the higher levels and in the company. And so it's really just been different with each studio and network, kind of how their system works. And so in that sense, you know, it's like every studio has its kind of its own way, right, of like kind of running things. So I think what's helpful is that when we have them repeatedly sponsor us, we've kind of like, you know, getting our foot in the door, we're getting in, you know, inside the room, and it's like, you know, slowly we're getting like closer because we're building, you know, up with the kind of longitudinal study that we're doing. We're building like our case, and I think that has helped. So, you know, this next round should be interesting to see, you know, after 4 reports, like how much more we can push it to the top. And so in that sense, you know, I think we are making headway, but it's really just trying to kind of keep pushing up, you know, to the top of the companies to try to influence the biggest decision makers there.
Yeah, and just to really add another really quick point, and I think with Amber, who said it earlier, that, or maybe it was Vanessa, I don't know who it was.
Oh, yeah.
Someone said that this is a multidimensional problem. You know, it's not just the studios, it's not just the networks. We have talent agencies, we have the employment guilds. I mean, everyone in one way or another is a part of the problem and a part of the solution. You know, and these things have to happen at the same in the academies. I mean, you know, like Oscar So White, that's a great critique, but you know, if they're not making the films, you're not gonna get the nominations, you're not gonna get the awards, you know. So, you know, all these things have to happen simultaneously. And what's happened in the past is the passing of a buck. Everyone blames someone else. The talent agencies say, oh well, you know, we're in the business of selling, so if the networks told us they wanted diversity, we give them diversity. And the networks turn around and say, oh, well, you know, we're trying to develop these diverse projects, but we just don't get anything from the talent agency. So everyone has an excuse for why it is we can't make headway, and no one accepts their part of the responsibility. And so we never get anywhere. So what we try to show in the report, because we do have a whole section on the talent agencies, who are a huge part of the problem as gatekeepers, that every sector of the industry is complicit in the problem we have right now. We have data to show how they're part of the problem. And some of the individual donors we have are only one part of the problem, so they might not be totally in control of it, but they at least have to acknowledge their role. You know? And so that's why I think we see a little bit more headway at some places and not as much at other places, because at the end of the day, they're still dealing with agencies that have gone backwards, that they've gone nowhere in terms of diversity. Yeah. I mean, they're just becoming more and more dominant in terms of their control of the market, and yet they haven't diversified an inch. You know, so that explains a lot of the packaging that happens in network and in film. And we have data to show that. Over the course of our report, they become more dominant, you know, in terms of the whole market. So.
And when, yeah, the top agencies, you know, say, well, we're only going to represent the top talent. And so they say, you know, we're only getting A's. But then, you know, for them, that what they're looking for is white talent, you know, that they think is like the A's. And so, and then, or, you know, really well-established people of color, you know, eventually then they'll represent them. But, you know, somebody trying to make it into the industry, if you're not going to be represented by those top 3 agencies, then, you know, you really, it's hard to get in to get into like a great deal and to be on like a hit show. So, you know, it's just obviously very
difficult. We did about 14 different talent agencies who were responsible for sort of all of the leads in television. In the year we looked at. And 3 of those 14 agencies controlled about 90% of all the TV, all the TV shows we looked at, right? So that gives you a sense of how dominant it is. And we're talking about, you know, huge companies that are diversified in all other types of directions, and they do what's called packaging. They will come up with, like, looking at their talent rosters and say, okay, we'll put Brad Pitt with this hot writer, with this hot director, and we'll sell it to this studio, this network. Well, guess what? If you're a person of color, you're probably not on their roster. And guess what? You're not going to be a part of the package. So when you look at our statistics, you see year in, year out, that's why the numbers are so low, because they're not part of that 90% of everything that's on TV. Basically, people of color, for the most part, with a few exceptions, there are a few, you know, really high-level minority talent who are repped by the major agencies, but that's not most talent. They're kind of the leftovers, you know, in terms of that small percent we see that actually gets work. And so that's one way in which it's locked out. So it's almost like institutional racism. Because of the way the agencies are structured in terms of race, the agents are like 90-something percent white and mostly men who develop these rosters that are mostly white in terms of the A-listers and packages that are created by show creators who are mostly white, so therefore it's not going to be a minority story, so why would you have a minority cast? Or if you do have a cast, they're going to be just friends of the lead, you know, that type of thing that we saw. So that's the structure that reproduces over time the same types of outcomes that we're talking about. So we're trying to figure out how to expose the structure and the process and the numbers, and to show that, okay, that's fine and all, but you're losing money, because this is what the audience over here wants, this becoming more and more diverse every day.
My name is Katya Antoine, and I'm an anthropologist here from UCLA, and I want to thank you for this report too. I use it in a company that I have just started called Excited, where we work on offering what I think of as cultural insights analysis for scripts, commercials, other types of media products, advertising, merchandise, posters, anything that can be analyzed as text, and trying to influence not only who gets cast, but what are you cast into, so that audiences of color resonate with depictions of themselves that actually are multidimensional and not don't necessarily always play on race and things like that. So with that, I know it's not the topic of your data, but I'm wondering if you have impressions or anecdotal thoughts about of these few percentages that actually are people of color, to what extent are they actually representing in a way that resonates, that is, or is it all stereotypes and you're playing only your race? If you're a black person, then you have to be black and do what black people do or whatever it is, right? So I'm curious if, from all of you, if you have impressions of that.
I don't know if I have any unique anecdotes, and definitely not anything that's representative. But I will say that that's a fascinating business model. It's kind of a one-stop shop for cultural know-how. So I don't have anything like representative data on it, but I think it's something that we should constantly stay vigilant for, that representation, even though it's a necessary step, it's not like the end-all be-all of what we expect from our media. That we're not just like showing up on the screens, but that it also does reflect all of us. And I would say that, that can also come up in insidious ways. Like the obvious ways is that if you have a show, maybe it's a reality show, this happens with a lot of reality shows, where there's people of color being represented, but the representations often play to stereotypes and such. But there are also further layers in that. This is not to call out any single show or any one case. I mean, everybody's doing what they can. But if you take a show like Fresh Off the Boat, it's largely helmed by people of color. And I think it makes a very important historical step. But if anybody was following the controversies that was happening as it was coming out, you notice that the large divide that happened between Eddie Huang, who wrote the memoir, and the people putting together the show is whether they wanted to show a very specific Taiwanese American experience in Florida, or whether the show was supposed to be geared towards a general kind of immigrant experience, and then further on to a kind of like more traditional, like fish out of water experience that was meant for like a very general audience to identify with. So there's nothing really insidious about either one of those discourses, but it does get in the way of specific audiences resonating with it, whether the depictions of certain cultures are, say, watered down or made so that
homogenized, so that
a general audience can understand it. So we should always be vigilant, I think, against a kind of cultural dumbing down. You know, media should represent, you know, the communities that it comes from, and we should be vigilant that it does.
Yeah, I'll add to that with the Fresh Off the Boat controversy. I mean, there's a few other shows that I think have experienced similar things, but even the question over whether or not the mother should speak with an accent was a big issue, and she spoke out as her, you know, as an actress herself, saying that she took pride in the idea that this person could have an accent, and that she didn't see that as like a racial problem or a racist problem. But many people took that, I think, in similar ways to the way that Sofia Vergara often, you know, she plays up her accent and jokes get written to play up the accent, and that creates a lot of divides among Latino communities. I think the issue with any changes is that changes upset. And so if you see an increase in diversity, the various communities who are represented may get upset, but it's still important that the diversity is happening. I think the biggest problem, I mean, you talked about, you know, can Latinos or Blacks only play Latino or Black? Can, you know, queer people only play queer people? Like, that's an ongoing problem, and I think that's one of the more upsetting, I know we don't have exact numbers about that, but one of the more upsetting things is how much there's still people, white characters, white actors playing people of color. With the numbers that we have here, it's inexcusable. That's inexcusable. But there's still the question about how specific culturally or racially or ethnically do we get in these things. Like Dora the Explorer is like a great example of, you know, bringing kind of a Latino culture to the forefront, but that's also a homogenized Latino, right? Like she's purposefully not supposed to be attached to one particular demographic. So I don't have an answer, but I think that these are kinds of ongoing questions, and I think the bigger thing is that people of color should be able to get roles, whether they're playing their own race or others, because why is, you know, white this kind of like neutral that can play any race, any, you know, ethnicity, any gender, any sexual, you know, identity, but people of color are just left out of the equation. That's the bigger.
I think Shonda Rhimes does a great job of that in casting people who are doctors,
mm-hmm.
and they're not specific. They're doctors of all kinds of backgrounds, just like doctors are, without having to be a thug who ended up being a doctor or something. You know, these crazy stretches of the imagination to make sure race somehow is fitted into the character in that way.
We got the issue with stereotypical. I'll let you go.
To briefly, just from the talent side, I do see a lot of casting calls. And I think in the same way that we racialize people of color, white roles are also racialized, so that only white people can play the characters, just in terms of some of the language that's used, it doesn't translate. So I'm fortunate in being represented by WME, which is a top agency, so I do have access to...
One of our sponsors, by the way.
Yeah, no relation.
No relation.
I have no idea, but you know, and that
that'd
was
be
like
interesting
a,
if you sold them, huh?
I don't know what the consequence would be, but the celebration was that I'm so fortunate that I get to read for these roles that normally aren't given to women of color. But then I read the roles and I'm like, well, this doesn't translate either, right? So I think there is an issue in terms of writing, right? Who's writing these scripts, and what does their world look like? So again, to our earlier point, that, you know, there are a bunch of different aspects of the industry that need repair in order for what we see to actually kind of represent the kind of diversity that we want.
And all of the individual places are necessary, but none individually is sufficient.
Exactly.
They all have to kind of happen at the same time. I just went back to this representation slide because that kind of goes to the point you were making about the images themselves. which we tried to gesture toward in our last report. We actually did a content analysis of so-called diverse shows, you know, based on the representation of bodies, what were the images like? And we found some interesting patterns in terms of different types of portrayals of different groups and where those portrayals fell in the pecking order in terms of who gets credited with the highest billing versus lower billing, you know, gay and lesbian representations, where those show up, whether they're like early at the top of the billing or much further down, we found out, even on the so-called diverse shows. So there are some issues there, some representation of issues. And the trade-off for the type of analysis we did, which was quantitative, is that, of course, you don't have the type of nuance and meaning explication that you would have if you did a more qualitative study, which, of course, then would suffer from the fact that it's not representative. And so we had to make trade-offs with that. So we haven't, you know, systematically done the type of qualitative analysis of the actual images themselves. I mean, with the exception of that content analysis we did last year. But 2 years ago. But I can say anecdotally that I think what's different now is that in the past, before you were in the so-called golden age of television, there were like one or two shows on TV that bared the burden of representing the entire group. So like in the 80s, you had the Cosby Show, and that was it for black people. So the Cosby Show had to do everything, and there were some people who loved the show because, of course, the show was trying to be positive in terms of its images. And of course, politically, we now know from the research that it had the exact opposite effect. It kind of played into the Reagan era, you know, family values arguments that were used to demonize black people. So it had the exact opposite effect, despite the fact that the images were positive and not stereotypical. So damn if you do, damn if you don't. So people can read images in different ways, and it's an empirical question as to how they're gonna read them. And the historic context has a lot to do with it. The other texts that they're engaging with have a lot to do with it. I think the reason why we're in a different place now is because there are just so many texts. I mean, you have Atlanta, which is, if anything, that's a, I don't know if you want to use the word authentic, but it's not the type of black representation you typically saw on TV. You have Insecure, you know, Issa Rae's show. You have all these shows that are unapologetically black in many ways. They're very sort of fixed in a given location in ways that the more general, let's say, black sitcoms of the 1970s maybe weren't. And you're reading that along with Shonda Rhimes shows, which are, for the most part, race neutral. I mean, she gestured toward it with Sally Hemings and Thomas Jefferson a couple of times in Scandal, but for the most part, people were just people who happened to be this, that, or the other. And she got a lot of criticism for that early on because there wasn't a lot of other representations of black experience and black stories, and you have these black characters, but they're not black, you know, so that was. But now, of course, given the fact that we do have the other representation, people are reading Scandal and How to Get Away with Murder differently. The context has changed. So it's a complicated issue, and certainly not one you can get at with numbers, you know what I mean? And it's the type of thing that, you know, as an anthropologist, you know, you have to sort of do your, what we call audience ethnography in media, to get a sense of how audiences are actually reading the show. And that's not something we've been able to do yet, because as you might imagine, it's a very labor-intensive process that wouldn't allow us to do an annual report, because by the time we kind of got the findings, we'd be onto something different in terms of what people are watching.
Right.
So,
thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Do you look at, like, globally, what the impact of
Well, we haven't done that with television because, you know, shows, yeah, you're right, they're packaged and they're sold and distributed. You know, globally, but we have done that with movies, and what we found is all of that is just it's BS basically. It's just an excuse for why they can't do that, because the figures I showed you for film were all global box office, and so we're talking about where global box office peaks, and using sort of diversity of the cast as we understand it within the American context sells incredibly well overseas. Those films on average are doing the best. And so take a film like Theory of Seven, which appears in our database this year, made $1.5 billion with a B, globally. Number three rated film that year, majority minority cast, Asian American director, leads all people of color, 61% of the office, I mean box office for that film was people of color, in the US. But globally it made $1.5 billion. And so one of the arguments is, well, that's just, you know, it's the genre, it's an action film. Action films will, who cares who you put in it, they'll do well. Well, because we've done 4 years of this, we were able to pool all of our films across 4 years and divide them into genre and to look at, you know, films by genre, by cast diversity and box office, and lo and behold, we found the same pattern. Regardless of genre, films that were more diverse made more money if you pooled all the films over a 4 year period. So it stands to reason. I mean, for all the reasons we mentioned earlier, people want to see their stories told. They want to have characters they can identify with, that they feel resonates with their own realities. And look at the rest of the world. I mean, you know, Europe is maybe, what, 19% of the world's population, 22% of the world's GDP? That's a lot of leftover people and money that Hollywood's not marketing to that looks like diversity in America. So why wouldn't those films do well? You know? So it's just it's a false argument. It's an argument that excuses business as usual, excuses white men in executive suites making the types of films they know how to make, you know, as opposed to bringing other people in with other perspectives who unfortunately have to share their power with, which is where the, you know, which is what they don't want to do.
And like for TV shows now with Netflix, because it's like international, you know, they the studios can sell the shows to Netflix, and you know it gets around the world with just, you know, the like the, what's it called, when they lay in like the track of you know, different languages. The dubbing, yeah, most of it is like dubbed when it's like when it's TV show or something, and so. You know, I think that they see now that there is that market that they can sell all kinds of shows, and because around the world, everyone is interested in like American culture, and I think that, you know, they no longer just think that it's white culture, right? And so they want to see Black culture, Latino culture, and, you know, or relate to it or something. And so I think that the studios and networks are getting smarter about that. They are seeing that they can sell their TV shows. You know, that's not, it's no longer like this idea that they've been stuck with in their heads that, diversity won't travel to, you know, globally.
And just, you know, and the other thing is, increasingly the old model, you know, take a film that's supposedly diverse, set in another place, and throw a white actor in the lead, those films have been failing miserably lately. The Green Wall. You know? I mean, lots of examples. The one set in Egypt. What was the gods of Egypt or whatever? I mean, you know, they've been failing miserably. You know.
Keep whitewashing like these roles, and it's not working because it's not authentic. And so I think that that's the problem, is that audiences see that, and even the way that they market like the movie too, it's a miss, because like even that movie, The Wall or The Great Wall. With Matt Damon, apparently, you know, it's filled with, it's made by an Asian director, you know, from Asia, and it's filled with actors that are international actors.
But he's the lead.
But he's, yeah.
He kind of becomes his story.
And he's marketed also as the lead and as like the savior character. But supposedly within the movie, it's actually, there's five heroes. But like there, you wouldn't know that if you just saw the trailer, right? It was marketed in the U.S. And I think then, you know, they made that big misstep of not knowing that, you know, this doesn't seem authentic. Why would Matt Damon, of all people, you know, be there, right? And so, yeah, and so it shows that it's, like, that's like a great example of like that, you know, the studios thought, okay, we're going to get into the Chinese market and we're going to, you know, make so much money out of it. Just, you know, throw this, you know, Matt Damon in, he's such a big star, that no, everyone wants to see the, you know, big American star, but they marketed it so, you know, incorrectly, and so then obviously, you know, hasn't made that much money.
Yeah, and one other thing I forgot to note, when I was talking about box office peaking, so we also looked at the top 10 films ranked by box office and who bought the tickets. We have data on ticket buyers, and people of color bought more than half the tickets for 5 of the top 10 movies. So half of the top movies that year, many of them made over $1 billion. The majority of the tickets were bought by people of color. The previous year, 4 of the top 10. So there's a trend. It's moving in that direction. So moviegoers of color are becoming increasingly, if they're already half of the top films in 2015, they're becoming an increasing force in terms of who's actually buying the tickets. So you cannot keep making movies that don't align with what these audiences are clearly showing they want in terms of where the things are peaking. And that's kind of the takeaway that we've been, you know, repeatedly emphasizing to the studios and to everyone else who will listen, in terms of
the clear patterns and trends over the last few years.
And I ask that because I'm trying to get at why this seems, risk, so you're afraid that it's not gonna
It's culture, it's power, it's sort of, again, the way the industry is structured. And so how do you shake up the executive suites? That's the question. Because until that happens, it's not changing in a major way. We're tinkering around the margins. It's not. Because they're not equipped to make these films. They don't know how to make them. They're very good at what they know how to make. But to write a story that has all the qualities that you're talking about in terms of sympathetic portrayal of these characters, that don't offend, that are not stereotypical, that show the diversity within a category and a group, well, you gotta know something about that. And they probably don't. And the people who are their best friends, that they're used to working with, who have a track record, where there's that comfort zone, they don't know how to make it either. You have to bring people in the room who have those skills. And they've been reluctant to do that because it means giving up some of their control over the decision-making process. And so ABC Disney, obviously, it's in their interest to do that and to increase their shareholder value, right? But physically, how do you do it? Do you just fire everybody and bring in new people? How do you do it? And I think that's what they're struggling with right now.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Oh, so I
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
I'm on the board.